one wobbled him.
Drops him. And here we go. This is a championship fight.
This is MMA Fight Corner on Fox Sports Radio and all over the world from the mecca of mixed martial arts, Las Vegas, on UFCRadio.com. Here are your hosts, Heidi Fang, Phil Devine, and Joey Varner.
Hey, this is Mike Goldberg, voice of the Ultimate Fighting Championship, and you are listening to the MMA Fight Corner. Here we go! Here we go!
All right, Las Vegas, happy Friday evening, and welcome to the MMA Fight Corner here on Fox Sports 920 in Las Vegas, and streaming worldwide, still yes, streaming worldwide on FSR920.com. That's FSR920.com for your host, Joey Varner, Phil Devine, and Heidi Fang. I'm the referee for today's action, Dave Carney. And ladies, gentlemen, we've got in studio with us today a very large and a very special guest. This is the president of the World Series of Fighting, six-time kickboxing champion, and I don't know how this happens, but two-time Hall of Famer, Ray Sefo. Ray, thank you so much for joining us today in the corner. How are you, buddy?
I'm good, thank you. Thank you for having me.
You forgot part of it. You said large, but you forgot the in charge.
Charge. Doesn't that kind of always go with the large part?
Salute
when you're large,
him.
You're in charge.
Salute him like he is your Sarge.
Hey, listen, if I had offended you in a dream, I would definitely wake up, apologize right away. I'm sorry. Ray, I sent you a text this morning. I had a bad dream. Apologize about that. So, Ray, thanks so much for coming down, joining us this afternoon on the corner. It's a real pleasure to have you in studio. Let me ask you, first of all, how long have you known the miscreant we know as Joe Stradamus, Joey Varner, here?
I don't know him.
You don't know him at all? I was going to say, I wouldn't admit.
He denies all knowledge. Never seen him before.
I wouldn't want to admit to that either, Joey, actually.
It's probably been about 10 years, right, Joe?
Yeah, easy. Yeah. 10 years.
Wow.
Yeah, it's been so long. So happy together.
I still have nightmares.
I was going to say, and yet you're still successful. So, Joey, don't ever let anybody tell you otherwise.
Exactly.
Guys, we have a real, real big show today on the corner. We're going to talk a lot about the World Series of Fighting 3 with Ray. That's coming up Friday, June 14th at the Joint inside the Hard Rock. And, of course, this is going to be televised once again on NBC Sports. Ray, I'm gonna start off with you and talk a little bit about, first of all, the World Series of Fighting, just in case folks listening to the MMA Fight Corner have never heard of the World Series of Fighting before.
Well, it's a league that myself and a business partner started. You know, it came up through a discussion one time, and we put it all together. We brought a team on board, and it's one of these things, just like any other company, where you've got to find the right people and put them in the right places and move forward. And 2 years later, we had our first show, and now we have a 3-year deal with NBC Sports Network. So we're, you know, a platform that for us is an amazing platform, but also for our talent to showcase their skills. So we're really excited and happy about it.
And we were talking a little bit off air before we started about the incession, how it actually came about, how the birth of World Series of Fighting. It was actually your brainchild, and it was, you know, spawned out of bad experiences and hope to create good experiences. Tell us a little bit about that.
So you want me to tell that story again?
Only the truncated version, okay? Because we've got the rest on 60 Minutes coming up later today.
Right. I couldn't have put it better than that. From all these experiences I had, I was doing an interview regarding my K-1 days and how much, you know, K-1 still owed me, you know, $1 million and everything else that and other fighters, of course. And of course, I had friends that were also competing at other different leagues, and one of them is Jordan, who was owed hundreds of thousands of dollars after winning Super League. And and something clicked that night during that interview, and I was going to call my buddy, and the next day he calls me at, now this interview took place at 7 o'clock Friday night, he calls me at 8 o'clock Saturday morning and asked, you know, to ask what I was doing. And it's crazy, because I was going to, I had heard he was out of town, so I was thinking of calling him maybe Monday, Tuesday. He calls me the very next morning. And long story short is that we catch up with him. You know, I go have breakfast with him, and I says, you know, what's up? And he says, bro, you know, I've been thinking about talking to you this past 3-4 weeks about starting a fight league. And I just looked at him and I said, what? You know, did you listen to an interview last night? And he says, what interview? So he had no idea. And I said, well, that's exactly what I was going to talk to you about. And that was the birth of Words of Fighting. And so, you know, we pretty much went to work. Two years later, we come out and make history being the first league to have a first show on national television.
Yes.
First outing. And so, and now we have a you know, an amazing partner as in NBC Sports Network. And can't be any more excited than that.
Well, what's the relationship, sorry, like been like with NBC Sports? Because we've seen, you know, you had your first show, and then there was a bit of a break till the next show, and now the third show coming out quicker, and you already have the fourth show signed. Right. So they obviously must be happy with what you're producing.
Well, absolutely. I mean, the deal is we have a minimum of 6 fights per year. That's the deal with NBC Sports. Now we could do 8, 10, if you know, whatever. The first two shows, obviously, I mean, the first show, obviously, we had to prove to them that we're capable of doing what we do. And the second show, which is the one that we just had a month ago, it made them realize that, you know, they need to be in MMA, number one, number two, that we, the team that we have, are capable of producing that type of show. And so they're 100% on board, and you know, they love the show and everything else.
Tell me how you got the second World Series of Fighting to kick off with all of the cage issues at the last minute with the Decagon and the commission. That seemed pretty insane to go through, and you were having parts shipped in.
That was scary.
Yeah,
leading
I was
up
like,
to
come
the
on,
event.
Tell
we
me
were
it's
at home,
happen.
Like, what's going to happen?
You know, the crazy thing is, I had no idea this was happening. I found out through Twitter.
Oh, no.
I you know,
that's where you get all your news.
I was going to say, that's the late breaking news source now.
Yeah. I'm like, what? So now I'm calling my staff downstairs, finding, you know, to find out what's going on. They say, oh, well, they're saying, the commissioner's saying that it's 6 inches shorter, their pads are too thin, you know, and so on. And what, you know, what I didn't get is that an interview was done, obviously, for this to have come out. And instead of, you know, waiting to get everything sorted, because, you know, it kind of made me upset a little bit, because now it had got our fans kind of like, okay, so this is not going to happen. They're doubting the situation, you know. And I obviously got on Twitter and said, guys, listen, the show is going to go on. Believe me, everything. So our team obviously had to scramble, get the canvas made, flown out back to Atlantic City the very next day. Fortunately, we had another guy that was working for us. Who runs a small show in Atlantic City, Rob. And he had his pads, he had his scale, and everything that was needed, you know. It was kind of crazy, but, you know, the first show, I didn't worry. You know, it didn't bother me one bit. Everything ran smoothly. The second show, that night, the night before the fight, I think I almost had a mini heart attack.
Yeah, but it's, you know what? It's funny. It's when, anytime you're doing anything in life, whether it's business, relationship, or anything at all, it's not the smooth sailing that makes you better, makes
right.
you stronger,
That's
makes
right.
you more confident in your product. It's when you have to face adversity, when you come into contact with difficulties, and you don't just, you know, rise to the occasion. You knock it out of the park. You know
right.
what I mean? You put on an awesome show with down to the wire, you know, scrambling to make it happen. But you know what? We knew you would, you know, and there's always the people out there that, like they say, the haters gonna hate. They're just waiting for some negative piece of news, something bad, some gossip to travel. Like, for instance, you know, the Josh Rosenthal, it's very sad he
yes,
got in trouble.
Yes.
Well, you know, 3 days before that got out, there is this one guy, Front Douche Brian. You know, he's all over the Twitter, you know, breaking news, you know, but he's so excited to spread like bad news. You know what I mean? So there's always those people out there, but no matter what, you know.
Yeah.
You still go hit out of the park.
Nothing sure. travels faster than bad news. Nothing does.
I take that back. Dysentery.
You know what, though? But, guys, I mean, from – and you know, everybody that's worked behind the scenes on any sort of event like this – I don't care if it's the UFC, if it's the NFL, if it's the NBA, 35 to 45 minutes before game time, before showtime, there's always some big problem. Something's not working right. There's a camera down. It's a mad scramble, and it's kind of one of those things. You don't know it's a show until something goes wrong.
Right.
And then you know it's a show. So actually, that's when I get comfortable. I'm like, all right, our first things happened that's gone wrong. This is perfect. Now we know it's a show.
The first fires.
Absolutely. The first fires happen.
Absolutely. It's like fighting. I look at it, you know, on the business side. It's like when I'm getting ready for a fight. If nothing goes wrong, I'm a little bit worried.
Absolutely.
Right.
So, you know.
Much too easy here.
Yeah.
Much too easy.
Absolutely.
And if you're going to get, put all of that together and you have all of those issues, like, falling apart in New Jersey, which, last week there was a lot of issues at the UFC event and people were questioning Dana during the press conference about, do you have any issues with the commission? And he's like, are you kidding? This is New Jersey. I mean, New Jersey's the first commission. Las Vegas and most other states are based off of what New Jersey does. And Nick Lembo's, he's a pretty good commissioner. He does what he has to do. If you can get it away with it in Jersey, and pull it off, that means you've done it right.
Right.
Without having to bury any bodies.
Exactly.
That's usually what you got to do in Jersey.
I didn't know about that.
It's kind of like Las Vegas, just a little less.
It's a little swampy.
That as he's hiding the shovels. But, Ray, what? The second event, you face adversity. You kicked its butt. You came out. It was an awesome time. The fans, they were happy. But NBC was also happy because they re-aired the event 12 times in 30 days. And that just shows an amazing amount of confidence. But in addition to that, they also announced that above and beyond just showing the World Series of Fighting events live, they're also going to be a new show called World Series of Fighting Future Champs. Tell us about that, man. This sounds awesome.
Yeah, it truly is amazing. The fact that NBC Sports is network is right behind the brand World Series of Fighting. We had John Miller, who's the president of NBC Sports, sitting between Ali and I watching the whole show. And I think that was the first time he had sat live and, watched the – and he thoroughly enjoyed it. And it was – of course, there was discussions of a reality TV show, but how do you differ that from all these other reality TV shows? So, which is a fighting NBC Sports Network decided to start a show called WSOF, which is a fighting future champs. And what it does is it showcases our guys in the prelims. Because as you know, a lot of you guys know, sometimes the guys in the prelims put on a better show than the guys in the main card.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Most of the time.
Hungry.
Let's be honest. They're hungry.
Yep. Yeah, well, and you know what? We're going to talk about hungry. When we come back from this break, we're going to have Ray Sefo, Joey, Phil, Heidi are going to break down, Ray, some of the great fights that are coming up at the World Series of Fighting 3. The main event, of course, is John Fitch versus Josh Berkman. So we're going to be talking about that and a whole lot more. When we come back, we've got big MMA news. Also in the second half of the program, Dr. Burke from Hangover Heaven is going to be joining us here. He's going to tell you how Joey can get himself out of a hangover very easily. You're listening to the MMA Fight Quarter here on Fox 920 in Las Vegas and streaming worldwide on FSR920.com.
Fight Quarter.
Fight Quarter.
Live from the Fox Sports 920 studio in Las Vegas and streaming worldwide on UFC Radio.
All right, welcome back to the MMA Fight Quarter here on Fox Sports 920 in Las Vegas and streaming worldwide on FSR920.com. Now, guys, I just want to give a shout out real quick to one of our great sponsors, Dr. Richard Rothman of LASIK of Nevada. Joey, you and I love to talk about our friend Billy Mira, the fact that he got his eyes done from Dr. Richard Rothman. And does that make him see any better? I don't know. But we said the other day he looked at himself for the first time and noticed how handsome he was. Is that what you said?
Or wasn't.
Or
but
wasn't.
Dr. Rothman is the first guy since Jesus to make a blind see again.
And you know what? Dr. Rothman and his great staff are always there to help you out. And all you have to really do is go to our website at MMAFightCorner.com. You can click on the link. It's right at the top. Our industrious webmaster also has made that link even better looking and more accessible. Thank you, webmaster.
You're welcome.
Heidi, you have so many talents. One of the talents, though, that you've had is bringing in awesome guests, and we always appreciate how much work you do behind the scenes bringing us these guests. Today, we've got in studio, if you're just joining us on the corner, Ray Sefo, president of the World Series of Fighting, also a six-time kickboxing champion himself. Ray, they called you Sugar Ray during your fighting career. Isn't that right?
That's correct.
All right, and you got your first heavyweight title in, 1990 in New Zealand. Isn't that right?
Yes, that's
wow.
Right.
Look at that. He had to think about it.
You know what I'm thinking? In 1990, I was 10 years old. Does that scare anybody in here? I don't mean to be like that. But no, you're definitely probably like the baddest man as far as the head of these fighting leagues. Do you think you could take Dana White in a scrum or anything like that?
Are you guys, kidding me? Are you guys really asking this question?
I don't know if we should start that kind of thing here.
I didn't know if competing guys ever thought about that. Like, we're going to face off in a mascot fight, you know,
Dana's ever played rugby.
Ray, of course, is a world champion. He's one of the best kickboxers in
all
the
time.
World.
Yeah.
You know, the guy, one of the greatest fights in the history of kickboxing against Mark Hunt. Just an all-out war, going toe-to-toe. Was supposed to move on. This is actually the year that Mark Hunt won the Grand Prix, only because Ray got hurt, busting his hand on the thick head of fellow Samoan or fellow Tongan.
He is Samoan.
Yeah. You know, but. This is a whole other level. That being said, though, David can actually box.
I'm not saying
he's
looks
a
like
world
he's in
title.
He looks like he's in good shape.
He got some decent hands. I've seen him box. I've seen him spar. I've seen him moving
well,
around.
Since they're both a little bit, you know, older guys now, here's what I would think. We get those.
Well, you're just throwing it at Ray.
You know,
it was 1990. I was only 8 years old.
You do understand
he's
here in the studio.
You're gonna put big boxing gloves on, those padded ones. We could tape it. It would be fantastic.
I think it's funny.
He's gonna do it with you.
Dave thinks there's a barrier between the two of you.
You know what, though? Believe me, for my career, that might be the best thing that ever happened. I'd appreciate that.
As long as we get it on film.
Exactly. Well, we've got this, this camera.
Let's go.
All right, listen, Ray, let's jump back into it here because we've got you for the program, and thanks so much for joining us. But let's talk with the guys and Heidi here about the main event fight with John Fitch and Josh Berkman. Do you guys have any specific questions, or Ray, do you want to go ahead and roll off with, you know, what these guys bring to the card?
Well, it's a rematch, 6 years in the making.
Seven, actually.
Oh, yeah, 2013, huh?
Well, the main event is an amazing main event, especially because we all know what John Fitch can do, and also what Josh Berkman can do. But especially Josh Berkman's last two outings where four Wizards are fighting, he's just looked amazing. When he was able to put away Aaron Simpson. So
that was ridiculous.
With amazing fashion. 100% that he's confident, he's ready to come out and fight. And obviously, if he wins this, you know, we'll look at putting up for a title shot at some point. That being said, John Fitch is an intelligent guy. He knows the Josh Berkman of today is not the Josh Berkman that he beat 7 years ago. So without a doubt, both of these guys are going to be ready to scrap and wherever that fight goes, whether it be ground, standing, I think they're both going to be ready to win.
And Fitch, obviously, on paper, has a strong advantage in the wrestling department. But Berkman, though, you saw in the Gerald Harris fight that, you know, Gerald Harris is a great wrestler. I mean, he's right on the level with
Jones. So is Aaron Simpson.
And Aaron Simpson as well. And he was able to stuff those takedowns, negate it, keep it standing. He actually took down Harris a couple times.
Exactly.
And then he just slept Simpson in devastating fashion. So, you know, this isn't the same guy that John Fitch fought 7 years ago.
John Fitch, I'm sure John Fitch knows that. You know, and that's why it makes it exciting, because not only that they've both improved in their games, But it's a rematch, you know?
Right.
So
initially, this fight was supposed to be for a title. At least it was rumored or purported that way in the press conference leading up to the second World Series that there would be titles. Why did you guys have to hold back on that, or was there any particular reason?
Well, this particular fight wasn't, it wasn't actually meant to be a title fight.
Mm-hmm.
But Twitter said it was, so
I think that's where I got it.
Yeah, the news source, right, breaking news.
The thing is, you know, people forget that it feels like we've been out here for 10 years, but we've only had two shows.
I know.
And so for us to have a title fights, it was just too soon. We just feel like that we need to have a little bit more shows, get our guys out there a little bit more before we look at title bouts. And most likely either towards the end of the year or early next year.
I'll tell you what, I was so happy when you announced it wasn't for a title. My kudos went up, my hat went off to you, to Ali, just because, you know, so many promotions come out. They've got one show deep, two show deeps, and they have someone fighting for a title. It's like, the title's supposed to mean something. In order not just to win it, there's got to be depth in the division. There has to be a bunch of people, contenders that are nipping at your heels. There has to be not just a champion ready, but three or four guys behind him who are also contending for that belt as well, for the belt to mean anything.
Right, exactly, and that's the reason why, you know, we decided to, you know, kind of hold off on those on the title situation, because, again, you know, Joey's absolutely right. You got to have depth in what you do, and have four or five guys that's willing to contest for that title.
And one of the things, too, as well, is that you guys are really trying to do is develop your own brand of talent as well. You know, there's a lot of great talent that's already existing out there, and you know, you want to take advantage of that, but you also want to branch your own fighters coming up through the ranks. And you have an opportunity to do so with someone who's just so exciting, so dynamic. I'm hearing rumors. I hope it's not true. Say it ain't so, Ray. But I'm talking about Tyrone Spong.
Yeah.
Tyrone Spong is just – you fought him, actually.
Right.
In K1. I remember that fight. Right. And I thought it was BS. I thought you won. I thought a point should – I love him. But, you know, he held when he need. He clinched and that's – and that was against the rules, like the multiple knees and clinching.
You know what? Tyrone Spong is an amazing athlete. He's a great fighter. I was given a week's notice to fight him in that event. I still took him to the distance. But that being said, Tyrone is an amazing athlete. And the unfortunate thing is that he won't be on this card.
It's true.
So the visa issues are keeping him from coming in here. Is that what it is?
That's correct.
Okay.
I thought Glenn Robinson, his manager, had more money than God. Can he fix this?
Well, this is, you know, I thought the same thing too. But that being said, I spoke to Tyrone. He called me last week, and he says, Hey, boss, listen, I really wanted, you know, this to work out, but unfortunately I'm told by the embassy that I got, right now it's just a waiting game. And we, you know, he feels like if he gets his visa in 2 to 3 weeks, he's not going to have enough time to work on his ground, because obviously he doesn't have anybody to work with his ground over there.
Right.
And he just wouldn't give him enough time. So we've decided to pull him from the card just because of that reason.
And that was your co-main event, and he's such a strong co-main event. He's really the guy, the first guy. There's a long line of talent that you're developing, you're bringing up, but he's that first guy, I think, that has the potential to be branded as, you know, World Series of Fighters, Chuck Liddell or Tito Ortiz, the guy that you can build a brand behind.
There were people that tuned in for the first event because they knew Tyrone was fighting, and then it was like, wow, look at the rest of this that's going on, and they stuck around. But he is a guy, he absolutely is. He's such a dominating force that people really want to see what he's going to do in the cage.
So I know you can't really replace someone like that, but he was the co-main event.
Right.
What are your thoughts on? Are you trying to fill the co-main event? Are you just going to bump up a card, a fight earlier in the evening up to co-main event status? Can you even tell us right now? You want to break some inside news with us?
Yeah, our co-main event is going to be Tyson Steele and Steve Carl.
Awesome.
The reason why we decided, Ali and I decided to do that is because it tells a bit of story, because the winner out of those two will fight the winner out of Josh Berkman and John Fitch.
Awesome.
So it just makes for better sense for that to happen. And so we bumped those guys up to co-main.
Well, you know, let me actually transition real quick here, guys, because, again, we're on with Ray Sefo. You're listening to the MMA Fight Corner here on Fox 920 in Vegas and worldwide on FSR920.com. Ray, because we have you here in studio, there's some burning MMA news that's going on here. And I know Heidi's been waiting to kind of throw a couple of questions at you. And I want to open this up to the whole panel here with Joey and Phil. But, Heidi, let's start with you. You've got a question here for Ray, because you think he might be able to relate to this situation.
Well, I know that you are still in the position where you would maybe take a fight if one came your way that interested you. But I was thinking about what Chael Sonnen's decision has been, and after the last fight that he just had there versus John Jones, that he's decided not to retire, and instead he's going to fight at the light heavyweight class, and he wants to fight Wanderlei Silva. My question in that for you is, how hard is it to really either transition as a fighter, realizing that, you know, you are getting older and that there's a certain limitations that you do have as, you know, age wears on you? And I guess, is it, how hard is it to walk away from the fight game or to even change weight classes like that, make that to make that decision?
For me personally, it's not a hard decision at all. I still, you know, I'm still in the gym training and competing because I love it, I enjoy it. And I've always said that if one morning I wake up and I can't motivate myself to get out of bed and go to the gym and again in the evening for training camp, and then I'm done. So for me, it's hanging gloves up. It's pretty easy to do. Listen, Chael Sonnen is an intelligent guy. So, and I like him a lot. I think he's an amazing guy. It's one of these things where he's got to find peace with himself, whether he can make that transition. And if he can, how easy is that going to be? So I think he's just got to find, you know, the balance of whether, you know, the dieting is not going to hurt him, losing the weight down to that division. But hey, listen, wherever he goes and whatever decisions he makes, I support him 100%. He's a great guy, and I think he's great for the sport.
Well, what about you? Will you be fighting again?
Well, right now, yeah, I'm told
I will be.
This discussion is going back and forth between myself and Glory, most likely, and I'm waiting to confirm something within the next couple of weeks. But they got a show in LA and California, actually, end of July, maybe first week of August. So just waiting to confirm on that, whether that's going to, you know, if that can happen. If it happens, then I'll fight.
What about MMA? Would you fight MMA again?
Absolutely.
That's just awesome.
Yeah, absolutely.
I love it. And I got to go back to a comment you made on Chael, and you talked about his intelligence. And we will find out if Chael Sonnen is intelligent if he does the right thing with Wanderlei Silva. Okay? We know Chael's a trash talker, and he likes to promote the fight. You don't trash talk or try to promote a fight with Wanderlei Silva. I think Wanderlei Silva is the type of guy that he's not going to be like Anderson Silva. He's not going to be, you know, like John Jones afterwards, be like, oh, Chael's a good guy. I know he means well. He's just trying to promote the fight. Wanderlei is going to go in there with two hatchets and be like, I'm going to kill you.
Yes.
I am going to kill you.
I might actually chop your spirit out and eat that as well.
But you got to think about that. That's exactly how
Chael
Wanderlei approaches the fight. But that also plays very well into Chael's style. And I go back to just this last weekend, Sarah McMahon versus Sheila Gaff. Sarah McMahon, actually, when you watch her highlights, she looks like a female. You know, she fights like a female Wanderlei Silva. She comes out guns blazing, just throwing everything with bad intention. They're not straight punches in combinations that are set up off a jab. They're loopy punches that come in a barrage, a violent onslaught, you know, followed by elbows and knees. But it's straight forward. And just like Sarah McMahon was able to time that onslaught, change levels, get under the punches, and execute a perfect double leg takedown, that's what Chael can do as well. Now, Wanderlei does have an amazing sprawl.
Absolutely.
But the question is his sprawl better than Chael's takedowns? And
I know his submissions are better than Chael's submission defense. Mm. So
off his back, I got to.
Yeah, I don't know.
Who's Wanderlei tapped out from back?
Because Wanderlei just has a great time beating someone's face in, so he doesn't usually need to.
I know, but you made a point saying that his submission.
But he is a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt, and Chael has tapped to, you know, not the greatest of, you know, grapplers in the past.
I think the last time Wanderlei tapped anybody or submitted anybody was, what, 50 years ago?
He didn't. It was when you were still in diapers, right?
Oh, exactly. Gosh. Yeah. All right.
Just kidding. I love you, Wanderlei.
Exactly. Hey, you know what? That would actually be a super fight, though. And we've got that. Lots more to talk about here with Ray Sefo, president of the World Series of Fighting. They've got a big show coming up here at the Joint at the Hard Rock in Las Vegas, June 14th. Of course, it's going going to be telecast live on NBC Sports Network. So when we come back, more with Ray. We're also going to have Dr. Jason Burke of Hangover Heaven. Yes, that's right, Hangover Heaven, in studio with us, going to tell us all about how you can get yourself fixed up after a hard night in Las Vegas. You're not going to go anywhere. You're listening to the MMA Fight Corner here on Fox 920 in Vegas and worldwide on FSR920.com.
Live from the Fox Sports 920 studio in Las Vegas and streaming worldwide on UFCRadio.com.
All right, welcome back to the MMA Fight Corner here on Fox Sports 920 in Las Vegas and streaming worldwide on FSR920.com. Joe Stradamus here in the office. You look like you're about ready to fight Phil or something. What are you getting hyped up? Is this, having Ray in here, you want to try out for the World Series of Fighting?
This is how we stay in shape in between commercial breaks.
In between commercials.
We throw down a little bit.
That's good.
You know, but if you noticed, you saw him, he was nice. He was shadow boxing me.
Yes.
Because, like, the last 3 weeks in a row, I've walked out of here with black eyes.
That's true. And, you know, everybody says, you know, Heidi's, you know, giving you battered spouse syndrome here, in the office. You guys are all batting each other up. But, you know, this is a love fest. You guys love each other as a show host, right?
The only reason I don't really hit him is because for fear of Heidi. And I'm not talking she's going to kick me. She going to set me up. Like, I'm going to come walk out the thing, trip. She's going to put a banana peel there, and there's a knife on the ground sticking up, and I slip and fall on the knife.
Right.
You know how women
do,
especially Latin women.
I was going to say, boy, that's a full-on scenario. Joey's thought about that one a little bit.
Yeah. He's a wise man for planning ahead.
Yeah. Well, you do know what her nickname is, right?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. Hit man?
Tim Lane over at Couture, he likes to call her the Zohan.
The
yeah,
boy.
Because he was holding
does hair great.
He was holding pads for her one day, and he's What was that, your foot? Like, it just came up out of nowhere.
All right, so Heidi, we apologize in advance for anything we might say that'll offend you. I want to start this next segment because if you're just joining us right now on the MMA Fight Corner, first of all, shame on you because you've missed a great first half of the show. We've got Ray Sefo, six-time kickboxing champion and, of course, president of the World Series of Fighting in studio with us. Joey, you guys were talking a little bit off-air about something that I think is actually a really cool topic for this show. With a recent fighter here, why don't you go ahead and set Ray up for this one?
Well, yeah, we were actually talking about Chet Congo. And Chet Congo, he gambled, and the gamble failed to pay off, you know. His contract was coming to an was expiring, and the UFC made an offer before his last fight. He turned it down, was hoping to come out and have a devastating performance and get better leverage in renegotiating his contract with the UFC. You know, the plan failed. He got knocked unconscious. But, you know, Chet Congo is still a great fighter. He's got a lot of name recognition. So I was wondering if there was any interest by the World Series of Fighting in Chet Congo.
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, for us, I got to sit down and talk to Ollie and the team. If it works for us, it's going to make sense for us, you know, for that signing to happen. That being said, yeah, it's not a closed door to it. Obviously, we got to think about it and discuss it with the team and then go from there.
I'll tell you what would be an awesome fight, though. Chet Congo versus Arlovsky.
That would be fun.
That would be a fun fight. But, you know, they're speaking of free agents. There's a lot of free agents out there. One of them, is it true you guys signed Tyson Griffin?
That is correct.
Awesome. Love it.
I signed Tyson's Griffin's contract, I think, last week, actually. You know, it's funny. A lot of people have tweeted, you know, the same thing you've just said about Jack Conko fighting Andre Arlovsky. And they wanted that fight to be in, you know, like, in the next event.
Andre, not so soon.
Yeah, exactly. You know, listen, Andre.
Checks on medical suspension.
Yeah.
And so is Andre. Didn't he break his jaw?
Yeah, he did.
And
yeah.
That's another thing, too, about Arlovsky, that it was so many people, I guess, after he left the UFC and then he had that experience in Strikeforce, everyone was like, oh, he gets knocked out so easily. Listen, Anthony Johnson landed some brutal shots on him. Even Bigfoot, you know, when he fought Bigfoot, his chin is very underrated. I mean, but listen, everybody can get knocked out. Everybody's got a spot. But his chin is very underrated.
I don't know. I don't know about everybody. I seen this dude take some shin bones to the dome, and he smiled.
Look at the size of his head.
Right? No. Andre Arlovsky is, you know, I've always had respect for him for who he is. But the last fight, I became an Andre Arlovsky fan because he got hurt.
Could have been finished there in the first.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But he just kept coming. He broke his jaw in the first round, and he continued on to finish the fight. You know, that's true fighting spirit right there.
Well, a few years ago, one of the things when Bellator first came around, and you know, a lot of people asked Bjorn Remney about would you be picking up fighters that got cut from the UFC? And one of the things that it used to be with the UFC is if you lost two or three fights in a row, you were gone. You know, but that's not the case anymore. You know, they're thinning their rosters. Sometimes it's one and you're done, or sometimes it's even guys coming off a win. And if it's not exciting enough, or it's just they don't have the room, they get cut. Do you have any oppositions about picking up fighters coming from the UFC that are coming off of losses, or you know, first cut doesn't matter?
It doesn't really matter. I mean, what obviously we got to make sure that it works. That person works for us because you know, if you look at someone like John Fitch, for example, he's a huge name. He's still one of the top 10 in the world. He's an amazing fighter. And as a fighter myself, I understand that you're going to have your days, your bad days and your good days. Mm-hmm. It's just like anything in life. Sometimes you guys come to work and you're not feeling too well. And sometimes other days you're in here and, you know, you're trying to control Joey. But
there's no controlling Joey.
Good luck.
I like that. He tried to control Joey.
But, you know, so again, the fit's got to be right. And like I've always said, you know, the relationship, it's got to work both ways. And so if it's right for us, we'll make it happen.
Now, what has the relationship been with the fighters so far and their response? Because, you know, you talked about the reason that you got into this was because of the fighters and because of you and your friends being screwed over and stabbed in the back in the past. How has the fighters' response been to so far working for the World Series of Fighting?
It's been great. You know, everybody that so far we've signed and is on our rosters are amazing guys. And what makes me happy is that you know, we're getting emails and texts from our fighters saying, listen, hey, boss, just want, for example, Anthony Johnson, before his last fight, sent me a text and said, I mean, class act. He says, hey, boss, I just want to say thank you so much for the opportunity. I don't know what I'd be doing, you know, if you guys didn't come along. And so I really appreciate it. You know, just little things like that, texts like that means a lot. You know what I mean? Because it means that we're doing our job right and that we have a relationship with our fighters rather than just signing somebody and just throwing them in the cage and see wherever that goes.
Well, one of the things that I was looking at the World Series of Fighting website last night and I found very interesting, I was looking at your fighters and stunned by weight classes, and there was one weight class that's in there on your website that has not been on there, okay?
Right.
Atom weight, and you have women on the website. Right. Will we be seeing women in the World Series of Fighting?
Yeah, absolutely. That's,
yay! Sorry, I got excited.
Heidi, are you going to be one of those women?
I just need to work on my jiu-jitsu.
I'm a fan of women fighting.
And look who the woman is, though. Look who the karate hottie herself, Michelle Watterson.
You know, the thing is, 99.9% of the time you watch a woman fight, man, the women bring it.
They certainly do.
They bring it. And so, you know, that's going to happen. You know, I think the biggest thing for us is finding in depth in that in talent, and then we'll look at starting a division. But, you know, it's kind of hard because, you know, listen, Sharon Knapp is a good friend, and she's done an amazing job with Invicta and that. And then, you know, now UFC has women fighting as well. So I think it's just a matter of time, you know, for us when there's more women talent out there, especially now that UFC and Invicta also has it. So it's just a matter of time. More women are going to get into it, and then we'll find that talent.
Put me in, coach. I'm ready.
That might. Well, listen, I mean, you know, really quick, though, you know, speaking about, you know, the uniqueness of the World Series of Fighting, first of all, I have to say that one of the things that I, as a fan and a father of a young child, really appreciate about the World Series of Fighting is that tickets for these shows start at $29, okay?
Right.
You cannot get anywhere close to that at a lot of different fights. I mean, you know, the Mayweather fight coming up, thousands, right? A lot of UFC fights are sold out before you can get the tickets.
Getting tickets to the damn movies for that.
Exactly. So, I mean, with that being the case and the fact that you guys have found, you know, such an early bit of niche popularity on NBC Sports, I mean, your peak rating on there was close to 500,000 viewers on NBC Sports for your last show. Do you think that gives you an alternative type of a marketplace to attract an MMA fan, you know, like myself, who might not be able to afford the UFC event or the pay-per-view, et cetera?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously for us, again, you know, we've only had two shows. So for us, you know, we got to make sure that the fans come along and watch the show and enjoy it, of course. And our biggest job is making sure that we put on exciting fights that, so that the fans enjoy and they will continue to, you know, support and not only the brand, but also the fighters themselves and continue down that path.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're looking at this card, and you do have very exciting fights on here, especially when Joey and I were talking about earlier, the Dan Lozon and John Gunderson fight, very exciting. And in the past, I've made fun of Jacob Volkman many times on the air, right, and many times to his face. I run right afterwards, but I've made fun of him for, you know, some of his performances. But you have him in
because of his comments.
Because of his comments, too.
Post-fight comments.
Oh, that was, it's awful. But he got him in there with a great fighter and the perfect fighter for a guy like Volkman and Lyle Beer. Yeah, stylistically against Lyle Beerbaum, that's a great fight.
Right, exactly. You know, styles make fights, right? And it's one of these things where both these guys can wrestle, both these guys can go to the ground. Then it forces them to stand. So I think we'll see an exciting fight come out of that one.
Yeah, you either got a kickboxing match that's going to happen between two grapplers,
match,
or you're going to have,
right,
or like Joey says to say, it's going to like be like the Tasmanian devil, you know, on the around the ring or the cage, grappling
it's
all
like,
over the place.
That's like when the cat and the dog and
like a dust bowl.
They're just all over the place.
So
you couldn't see, you hear me, but you couldn't see me doing the hand motions of it.
Next time you
place.
Do it, just start spinning in the chair. I want to see how dizzy you can get.
Personally, go ahead.
No, I just want to know the first event you talked about. You've had two. First event was here in Vegas. Second one was in Jersey. Third, back here in Vegas. You already have a fourth planned. Where will it be? Do you know that yet?
It's either California or Miami, Florida.
Wow.
Very nice.
Fantastic.
Two vacation destinations.
Yeah, exactly. And Joey's all like, so do you have a color guy for these fights yet? Because you see, we've got a lot of experience
no,
right
you
here.
You know what? They can't have a color guy with more color in the world than Basito El Guapo Bas Rutten.
That's true. And, you know, I'm really looking forward to, you know, the continuation of this going on NBC Sports. Because, again, for a fan like myself that wants to see more MMA action, wants to see more of the great fighting. I mean, we're starting to get this out here in the world now, the Fox contract with UFC, things like that. But I'm really excited about being able to access this stuff without going through pay-per-view.
Right.
You know, being able to see it at home with a cold brew or something like that, watching it with the boy.
Absolutely.
You know, really great stuff. Now, before we let you go here, because we've got about one more minute before we're bringing on our second most touted guest of the day. We've been talking about this guy all afternoon, Dr. Jason Burke from Hangover Heaven, who will be joining us in our next segment. Ray, tickets are already on sale for the World Series of Fighting 3. They went on sale April 19th.
That's right.
Where can we get tickets right now?
At Ticketmaster.com, I believe, and also at the Hard Rock Hotel and Casino.
Okay, so Hard Rock Hotel online.
Right.
Right.
But, you know, on just changing that topic real quickly, we do have Joey Varner. That's going to be at Wizards of Fighting.
Oh, well, Joey, thanks for letting us all know. Appreciate it.
Hey, you heard it here first.
That's right.
The cat is out of the bag.
All right. Well, great. Well, congratulations, obviously, to Joey. You've out-hustled yet another competitor in your field. Way, you know, not mad at you, my friend. Ray, it's been an absolute pleasure. You're going to stick around here with us during the next segment. But when we come back, guys, we're going to talk about the best way to cure your Friday night blues on Saturday morning, and that is with Joey.
You know, it's funny. It's our Hangover Heaven doc himself. But I'll tell you what. Ray Sefo is the before guy because he'll hit you.
Right.
And you'll feel like you're drunk, and then the Hangover Heaven will come over and cure your hangover.
See, that's called punch drunk. I don't know if they've got a cure for that one. Yeah,
I think Dr. Burke does, though.
If anyone can come up with it, he will.
Yeah,
okay,
no doubt.
Check Congo. We're going to give you Dr. Burke's number. All right. You're listening to the MMA Fight Corner here on Fox Sports 920 in Las Vegas and worldwide on FSR920.com. When we come back, Dr. Burke of Hangover Heaven. Stay tuned. All right, welcome back to the MMA Fight Corner here on Fox Sports 920 in Las Vegas and worldwide on FSR920.com. If you're just tuning in to the MMA Fight Corner, you have missed a great show. We've got President of the World Series of Fighting and six-time kickboxing champion Ray Sefo in studio with Joey, Phil, Heidi, and myself. And right now, guys, the gentleman that we've been talking about this whole entire Friday afternoon, because, you know, as Friday night starts to come about in Las Vegas, we all start to think about our plans for the evening, what we want to do. You know, how we're going to feel in the morning is oftentimes a big part of our Friday night plans, but the guy that can really help you out of not just every Friday, Saturday night conundrum, but also like we talked about on last week's show, guys like Joey who are just looking to recover, Dr. Jason Burke from Hangover Heaven.
Look at this. When you look at the history of man, there's discovery of fire. Okay.
Indeed.
Discovery of alcohol.
Okay. The wheel might be up there.
Discovery of
women.
Coffee. Okay. And then there's not a lot of great things until you get porn on the internet. But then that second discovery, alcohol, is plaguing mankind for centuries, waking up hurting, hungover. I'm talking about, bro, once I hit my 30s, which, yes, I know.
That was like last year or something.
Yeah, I'm like 23 and act like I'm 16. Yeah. But you know, I started having hangovers that didn't just last for a couple hours or the afternoon or the day. I'm talking 3, 4, 5 days of hurting for certain. Lights hurt, close the curtains. I just don't even want to come outside. I feel like the troll under the bridge. Dr. Burke is now a lifesaver, and he's on my speed dial.
Doctor, did he have alcohol poisoning?
I'm sure he probably did at some point.
That's the thing is Joey had stopped drinking for the longest of times. Now we have to worry about the fact that now he's got a recovery process that he's going to start again like he used to.
Well, if folks weren't able to hear our show last Friday night here on the MMA Fight Corner, we had Dr. Burke on from Hangover Heaven. Hangover Heaven is getting Dr. national news and attention. You guys have been all over CNN, CBS, USA Today. You've got cameras and writers, reporters following you all around. Brief us real quick again on Hangover Heaven, and then let's talk, because we've got Ray in here from World Series of Fighting and fight fans everywhere. Let's talk about Vita Heaven as well today, okay?
All right, perfect. Thanks for having me on the show again.
Great to have you back.
All right.
You're a busy guy. Thanks for making time.
No worries. So Hangover Heaven is the first medical practice dedicated to the treatment of hangovers. I'm a board-certified anesthesiologist, finished residency at Duke University in 2001. We've treated over 4,000 clients at Hangover Heaven. We have a regimen of IV fluids, IV vitamins, IV medications to resolve your hangover. It works fantastic. We have many repeat customers. And as a result of Hangover Heaven, we had a number of locals who came in and wanted hydration therapy. And I created Vita Heaven as a result to help out people that are athletes. We treat a number of UFC fighters with B vitamin shots as well as IV rehydration. And we've had a number of people say, I just finished weigh-in. I'm fighting the next day. I need to get hydrated. And we have had the hardest time finding someone to give us an IV after weigh-in, and the last place you want to go is some dude in the back of the stratosphere to get your IV.
Because you ain't getting an IV.
I got some clean needles somewhere.
Right, and so word's getting out that we do a great job. We've treated Anthony Njokuani with B vitamin therapy. He won his fight back at UFC 159.
Devastating knockout.
Mm-hmm. And he looked good doing it. He's looked real good in his last few fights. And now last week we had an instance where Nick Catone, a UFC fighter, didn't make weight. Okay, and then after that, he had to be sent to the hospital because mm-hmm. of dehydration. How would you have prevented that?
Recovery is an important thing, especially as people get towards 30. I'm not sure how old Nick is, but a lot of the UFC guys I treat are in their late 20s, early 30s. And that's when people have issues with recovery. And it's the B vitamins, it's the hydration. People are doing two-a-day workouts, and people these days really push themselves. And so it'd be a matter of someone like that, especially if he had a history of being dehydrated before, to follow along his electrolytes, look at his fluid status, maybe giving him IV, a week before weigh-in, and maybe modulate the amount of fluid that we're giving him and really make sure he has a dedicated plan to make sure he can make weight and still fight the next day.
Yeah. Well, tell us about that process, though, is that what actually happens when a fighter does dehydrate themselves, and how important to their health, well-being, and performance is it for them to get the proper rehydration?
Well, it's not just the dehydration. It's also the fact that when people are trying to cut weight, they're losing water, they're losing electrolytes, and they're losing vitamins, because generally they don't have the best diet while they're doing that, and they're taking diuretics, laxatives, all sorts of different things to make weight. And so even though you may get them rehydrated, you need to get the vitamins back in for people to be able to perform, because the vitamins act as the technical term is catalysts, but they're basically, you can think of it as a assistant to make energy for your body. So if you run out of B vitamins, you're just going to probably run out of gas in the first round.
It's so funny. Fuel TV has been showing the old Ultimate Fighters, and they're showing Ultimate Fighter Season 5. And if anyone remembers that, that's the one with Gabe Rudiker and the...
Come on, B, put me back in. Come in, I can
and
do
that,
it.
That was
you
one
make
of
the weight, B.
The worst showings of people, of a person trying to cut weight. Like, he ate like crap. That would be eating cake every night, and then the next day he's either in the sauna or getting colonics, And I remember BJ talking to everybody, and he's just like, why do you want to be here, man? I mean, are you a fighter, or do you want tubes up your ass? Why are you here?
What if it was just a little bit of both? You never know.
Hey, wait, hold on. I just want to hear your BJ Penn impersonation.
No, it was done. One and done, man.
Let me ask this question of Ray and Joey, and Ray, I'll start with you. You, like we talked about earlier in the show, Doc, Ray won his first heavyweight championship title fight in 1990. If you had access to this type of technology back then, how quickly would you have been to get on board with something like Dr. Burke is doing now?
Real fast.
I'd still be fighting every day.
Exactly. Back then I had no knowledge of nutrition, no knowledge of hydration or whatever. You know, I just, somebody says, for example, somebody said to me that by losing weight, drink a glass of water before you go for hot water, boiled hot water before you go for a run. I was like, okay, I'll try it.
Sure.
So, you know, understanding and, you know, the science behind all that back then was absolutely zero.
Sure.
So knowing all this and what, you know, Doc is saying, man, I wish I had it, you know, during those times.
And yeah. Joey, what about you? Do you think this gives you more fights because of stuff like the doctor has to offer? I mean, you're a big nutritionist now.
Oh,
I mean, you're hardcore.
100%. You got to think about this. When it goes from weigh-in day to fight day, you're going from feeling your absolute worst to having to perform at your absolute best. And anything you can do to help in that recovery process, to help minimize that agony of cutting weight and get you ready to perform at 100%, is going to increase the longevity of your career. In and above that, one of the things they talk about, though, is when you dehydrate yourself too bad, you know what it affects? Your brain.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're draining the alcohol. You're draining the liquid from your brain. It sucks. You're draining the alcohol.
Right.
That's my own brain.
See what we did? See what you did to him?
No, but you know what? And so a lot of these guys, though, if they
Doc, he needs help right now.
Yeah.
I'll be getting something out of my car.
They cut too much weight. They cut wrong, and they don't rehydrate properly using, you know, the lactated ringers and getting all the vitamins and getting the catalyst for energy back into their system. The first thing that's going to affect is their chin, their ability to take a punch, and they get knocked unconscious. That's the beginning of the end for a fighter. Once you get separated from consciousness, it becomes easier and easier to do every single time.
Yeah, and you know what the funny thing is about this, though, here, Ray, what we can't help Joey out with, is the fact that Dr. Burke and Hangover Heaven are mobile, okay? So if you're listening to us right now, I mean, it's 5:55 here in Las Vegas on Friday night. You're thinking to yourself, I've got a big night planned. I don't know if I can get to a certain facility, because you guys do have a facility. You know, tell the listeners first where the facility is and then about the on-demand service, so to speak.
Sure. So we have a clinic over on Highland Drive, right across the street from the Spearmint Rhino. Sure.
Like we said, location, location, location.
It was everything.
That's Joey's favorite place.
One-stop shopping, you know.
Exactly. So it's open 7 days a week from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. We also have a 45-foot tour bus that we treat people for hangovers on the bus. The bus generally works well for big groups. And then we also do in-room treatment. We already have 4 different in-room treatments scheduled tomorrow. Especially for our higher-end clients, we go into the room with all of our equipment, get them treated so they can get back to their vacation.
All right, here's a real quick important question before I throw back to Joey, Phil, and Heidi. Do you guys have any more room for appointments tomorrow? So if we've got folks listening tonight, fighters or just folks in Las Vegas, if they were to call your phone number at 900-0660, that's 900-0660, could they get an appointment for tomorrow?
Yes, at the clinic we have space.
Okay,
we're kind of booked for in-room treatments, but the clinic has space.
Okay, if you're listening out there, Joey's friends, you can still get
all two of you.
You can still get to treatment tomorrow. Call now at 900-0660. Okay, Joey, we got about a minute 15 here. You got another question here,
yeah,
for the doc.
Yeah, Doc, I'm actually at – is the VitaHeavenLV.com, is that up to date? Is everything up to date
correct.
On there, correct?
Correct.
And I'm looking at the services right now, and we haven't even cracked the surface – of the services you guys offer here. I'm seeing a high-dose IV, vitamin C, acetyl L-carnitine, performance hydration, B12 shots, Myers cocktail, and hormone therapy. So let's get with the last one. What exactly is the hormone therapy?
Well, I do male hormone replacement therapy. Guys, typically their hormones, their testosterone declines gradually over time, but with some people it crashes. And it generally happens in the 30s and 40s, and people have low energy, low sex drive, their memory becomes kind of off, and they don't know what's going on. It's kind of like, what happened to me? They find out they have low testosterone, we get them on therapy, and they're amazed at how good they feel.
What if you just want to feel extra amazing? Is that still something you can do? Like, is there like a little, I feel great now, but I'd like to feel even greater, like that movie Limitless.
The B-complex shots work great for that.
Okay, beautiful.
So actually, you'd get the B-complex shot, you'd get the hormone therapy, you'd get the performance hydration.
I'd get lift in my shoes, I'd be everything. I'd be taller, smarter, I'd have more hair.
So basically what happened is you'd become me.
Make you the man you've always wanted to be.
Exactly, with Joey Varner, apparently.
The Varner treat.
Oh, my
yeah,
gosh.
You should name it.
You know what, guys?
I
almost wish this hour didn't have to stop right now. We've had such a blast here. First of all, Ray Sefo, president of World Series of Fighting, looking forward to your next event coming up June 14th at the Joint Inside the Hard Rock, of course, on NBC Sports. Thank you so much for coming down. Joining us today, my friend.
Thanks for having me. It's always a pleasure to work with you guys. And again, you guys do an amazing job. And, you know, this whole process is it's a team effort, if you will. So without the media, we wouldn't be out here. So thank you, guys.
Hey, we're here to help. Oh, and yeah, Dr. Brother. Burke, I want to thank you for coming down again. You can check him out, hangoverheaven.com, or check out vitaheaven.com. Call him at 900-0660. Get yourself recovered. Get yourself the Joe Stradamus package. Dr. Burke, we'll talk to you next Friday right here on the MMA Fight Corner. For Heidi Fang, Filthy Phil Devine, Joe Stradamus, I'm Dave Carney. We'll see you guys on Tuesday right here at 5 on Fox Sports 920 in Las Vegas and worldwide on FSR920.com.